At its most basic, vision is about extracting information about the world around us from light. Now, the advantage of this is that it provides that information at a safe distance. If you think of alternative ways of obtaining information, such as, for example, touch, you actually have to go right up to the object in question in order to obtain that information. And if the object turns out to be dangerous, that would obviously be a risky thing to do. Other senses, such as olfaction, can also provide information at a safe distance, but they lack the temporal and spatial resolution which vision can give us. So vision really is unique at providing information at long distances, potentially very long distances, and yet keeping that high temporal and spatial resolution. So light, as I'm sure you all know, is part of the electromagnetic spectrum. And this includes everything from radio waves at very long wavelengths, through microwaves, infrared radiation or heat, through this visible spectrum from about 700 to 200 nanometers, then to ultraviolet light, which we can't see but some other species such as many insects can see, finally X-rays, we're familiar with their clinical uses, and gamma rays at very, very fine wavelengths. Yet out of all those different forms of electromagnetic radiation, we can only detect this very small portion, which is the visible spectrum. This slide shows why we evolved to be able to see that particular bit of the electromagnetic spectrum. Now, just a warning, this slide shows the spectrum flipped left to right from how it was on the previous slide. So on the left here, we have the very short wavelengths, the gamma rays, X-rays, and so on. And over here, we have the long wavelengths, the radio waves. And you can see that a lot of the electromagnetic spectrum is quite effectively blocked by Earth's atmosphere. So the opacity is almost 100% over many regions of the electromagnetic spectrum. And that's, of course, very good for us because gamma rays and X-rays would be harmful to us. They can damage our DNA and cause mutations. So it's great news for us that they're blocked so effectively by the atmosphere. But you can see just where we have the visible spectrum, there's a window, as it were, through the atmosphere where electromagnetic waves can penetrate particularly well. And fairly obviously, that's why we evolved, in order to be sensitive to that particular range of wavelengths. This clearly isn't a physics lecture, so I'm not going to go into great detail about the nature of light, but I do just want to give you a heads up that there are two ways of thinking about light, and I'm going to be flipping back and forth between both of them. So we can think of light as an electromagnetic wave, so an oscillation in the electric and magnetic field, or as little particles, little bullets of light called photons. So let's now think what information is potentially available in light. Well, because it's a wave, waves have amplitude or intensity, and so does light. So this is an example of a low intensity wave, and this is an example of a high intensity wave. And the intensity of light roughly maps on to our perceptual experience of brightness. Now, the photon way of thinking about amplitude or intensity is to think of the number of photons. So if you have more photons, you have more light, and we perceive the light as brighter. Waves also have frequency or wavelength, as we've seen, from the long wavelength radio waves to the short wavelength gamma waves. And even within the visible spectrum, there's a variation in wavelength from around 700 or 600 nanometers, which we perceive as red, all the way through to 300 nanometers, which we'd perceive as bluish. Waves also have a direction, so they can travel in a particular direction, and that's also something that we perceive, and that gives us the rich spatial information that our vision perceives. And to get that information about direction, you have to form an image of the light entering your eye. Early in evolution, creatures evolved that were sensitive to light, but had very little sensitivity to the direction of that, where that light was coming from. They didn't form an image, and so they didn't really have the detailed spatial resolution that our visual system gives us. We don't detect all information about light, though. Waves also have phase, so that basically means where the peaks and troughs happen to occur in the light. So this example shows waves of two different phases. They have the same wavelength, the same amplitude, but they have different phase. And that's something we're not sensitive to at all, because when light enters our eyes, in natural viewing conditions, the photons have got, every photon has a different phase anyway. Waves also, more complicatedly, have a polarization. Again, this is something you may have come across, and that refers to the plane in which the electric field is oscillating. So imagine the electric field vector going up and down like this. Okay, this is a little diagram of a wave, and then if you view this wave sort of straight on as if it's coming towards you, the E vector is going up and down like that. Okay. But you could also have the electric field vector oscillating in a different plane. So I've tried to sketch that there. So you've got the idea here is you've got a wave coming straight towards you, but the E field vector, instead of going up and down vertically like this, is going up and down at some oblique angle like that. And so that would be a wave that differs in polarization. We have a very essentially no ability to pick up polarization. But again, that's a limitation of our particular species. Other species, such as many insects, do have some sensitivity to polarization. Ants and bees actually use it to navigate because they can use the polarization pattern in the sky to work out where the sun is, even on a cloudy day, and use that for navigation. So what do we do with our information, all this information that you see have in vision? As we've seen, our eyes encode the amplitude or the intensity of of the light coming in, the frequency or the wavelength, the direction where it's coming from, and importantly, how all of those change over time. But of course, that's of very little interest to us as organisms. We didn't evolve to detect that information about photons. What we want to get from that is what the visual scene is outside. What are we looking at? Where are things in space, including how far away? How far would I have to walk to get to it? Can I reach out and pick it up? I want to know their size and the detailed shape. I want to know what objects are made of. For example, I want to know whether the fruit I'm looking at is ripe and good to eat or not. And very importantly, I need to know how things are moving over time. Is that tiger coming towards me, for example? And to end this introductory section, I'd like to show you an advert that was made by Honda a few years ago, just playing with the idea of optical illusions and how the images that project to our retina don't necessarily represent what's out there in the real world.
Those things that can't be done. Like less fuel in for more miles out. An impossible made possible.